Welcome back to another episode of Examining Life. Today I'm speaking with Paul.
Yes, Paul.
And what's your major?
Computer Engineering Information Systems.
Great. At Southern Connecticut State University?
Yes.
And the first question that we're going to discuss today is, by what method or source do you receive spiritual guidance?
I guess spiritual guidance for me, how I receive it, other people that I interact with, and perhaps the guidance that they give me, what I see what they're doing in their life that makes their life better, or mistakes that other people have made, so I don't make those mistakes, such as drug use or something extreme like that. Like I said, the spiritual guidance is more not from a god or religion necessarily. Mm-hmm. It's more the vibes that I get from other people.
Yeah.
That kind of spiritual essence that I get from
energy.
Yeah, that kind of thing, energy. I started reading about Egyptian mythology, and I was really getting into that more so than perhaps a Christian religion or anything else like Buddhist or Muslim. So I started to follow that somewhat in my spiritual sense.
Yeah.
I don't go to worship, I don't do any ceremonies or any kind of rituals or anything like that. But I continue to read more and more about it, and I try to look at it as the fact that there are many other religions that other certain millions of people believe this, millions of people believe that, and I wonder to me why are different people believing in different spirits or gods or whatever it is.
Mm-hmm.
So when I started reading about Egyptian religion, Egyptian mythology, it's, I'm not really exactly sure yet if it's a religion, if that's what they consider it. I should know that, I guess. But
some equivalent or close to.
Right.
Yeah.
Because there are gods.
Mm-hmm.
God of thunder, God of lightning, and all different. My parents were Protestant. My father actually was Catholic.
Okay.
Me and my brother were brought up as Protestant.
Okay.
You know, in the Christian religion.
Yeah.
And I guess I was around 12 or 13 when I told my parents, or maybe I was younger, but I told my parents I no longer wanted to go to church.
Mm-hmm.
Not because I started believing, stopped believing, but when I went to Sunday school, I found that the other kids that were my age there were very nasty.
Mm.
So that was like the first turn off of the religion as a whole, because the people that are supposed to be going are supposed to be taught to accept everyone. And when you have certain people, especially if you're young as children, acting that they're better than you, that kind of is like,
makes you question.
Yeah, are they being taught the proper way? Anytime that I've talked to a priest or a minister or a pastor, they pretty much say everybody's welcome to come. You know, you can't just tell somebody, oh, we don't like the way you look or the way you dress. You can't follow this religion because you don't fit the bill or whatever. So when I was getting that vibe, it steered me away over time. So when it goes back to spiritual guidance, I tend to, like I said, more so rely on the essence of other people, how they go about their day and how they treat other people. There was a video I was watching the other day. This man was driving his like Ford F-150 pickup truck. He stopped in the middle of a two-lane road or highway, blocked the traffic so he could help an old man cross the street, and he made everybody else have to stop too, which I was like absolutely amazed. Not that he did it, but that there's people that are willing to go that far to take the risk. And amazingly, people weren't beeping their horns and saying foul language or anything like that.
Right.
They waited and they said, wow, you know, they must have been thinking the same way I was thinking, like, that's really cool that this guy did what he did. So when I see something like that, I think, yeah, that's something that helps me think of the way I should be as well. So if you want to consider that spiritual guidance, that's the way I look at it.
Yeah.
The actions of others, more so than going to a church or a synagogue or something and worshiping. And
right. You can find ethics and morals in any kind of scenario or walk of life, not necessarily just in like religion. So I like that you can like that, because it seems like a lot of people do rely on religion for those morals and lessons,
right.
But it's not necessarily, it doesn't have to be relied on.
And if people actually have self-awareness and free will, Mm-hmm. You can make that choice, whether you're doing something good or bad, or how you act.
The second question that we're going to discuss today is, what is knowledge? Do you know anything? And if so, what do you know?
So knowledge, I would say, is what you have learned, or what you like personally know about a certain subject or subjects. I think I would say I know at least enough to get by if I needed to survive, like to not necessarily make money so I can buy food, but I know how to farm so I can grow my own food. I can build a fire so if I need to keep warm. I know some of the plants that you shouldn't eat or touch because you get poison ivy, you know, things like that.
Yeah.
So I'd say that I think I know enough to survive on Earth where I could sustain my own life. I think I know, I could say I know for the most part everything that I've learned, like say math. I'm very good at math. I remember how to do algebra. If you gave me a textbook of another math subject, I'd probably be able to do very well on any testing.
Did you learn in your Greek philosophy class about like Plato's hierarchy of like knowledge and like the forms?
Yes, we did learn about the forums. In fact, our last little test, I guess, was about the forums.
So, like, in Plato's forums, I believe his theory for the forums themselves was essentially math and numbers are what can be known. Do you agree with that, or do you think other knowledge can be attained as capital K knowledge?
I think numbers definitely has to do with a lot of things. Mm-hmm. When I was reading those books that I mentioned earlier, I don't know if that ties into this, but the Egyptian mythology, they do talk about numbers a lot. Mm-hmm. In fact, part of one of the books actually says that when you achieve a certain state of mind, I guess is what they're saying, you will see everything is, you will actually see numbers on the corners of the room and angles and stuff, as if you're in another dimension. So when it comes to the forms and like that, the numbers, definitely I think has to do with just everything. Length of time is numbers. Measuring the size of this room, or how big a car has to be, or the highway width, you know, everything is numbers and measurements like that.
Even as you mentioned, like building a fire, we don't always necessarily consciously are aware of those numbers, but you have to like be maybe at a certain angle or, you know, at a certain speed with like the wood to like create the fire. So even that, like,
how many sticks do you need? Or is it a Coast Guard? One of the main lessons I guess I learned or took from that was that the only stupid question is one not asked. Because in the Coast Guard, if you don't ask questions, you know what you're doing, people die. So that can apply to real life, not necessarily somebody dying, but bad things will still happen if you don't know what you're doing and you do something wrong and it hurts somebody. Somebody gets hurt in the process.
Right.
So it's good when you know something or anything about what you're doing.
Do you have to learn something in order for it to be knowledge, or can something be like intuitive?
I think something could be intuitive, like if it's survival skills or something, perhaps intuitive. Maybe not how to start a fire unless somebody actually taught you that.
Okay.
But if you're going to grow up where nobody's teaching you anything, eventually you're going to figure stuff out.
Yeah.
If you think of the concept of a caveman, they knew they had to eat, so they learned and they taught themselves how to hunt. Mm-hmm. Now, the elder would teach the younger how to do that. But in the beginning, somebody had to start and figure it out.
Right.
They discovered fire, whoever discovered. So there are ways that intuitive, like, what can we do to eat the meat or whatever, cook the meat? Or, I'm sure they weren't using those words necessarily.
Right.
but the like idea was concept, in their head. Sure, you know. Knowledge doesn't necessarily, like you're saying, is it intuitive? I don't think it necessarily has to be learned, but by being taught or gaining knowledge from experience, lessons learned by others, or just naturally because we made mistakes and it didn't work. Definitely knowledge is something that you gain over time, and you know they say the older the wiser. Not with everybody, but for the most part, what is knowledge? It's gaining experience and learning in ins and outs of everything that you go through in life. And one of the things actually in the philosophy class was that wonder. If you don't wonder about things, oh, how can I make this better? And that's what engineering is all about. How can we do something like a microwave or something so people don't have to put on their oven, they can just reheat something. If you don't wonder, then the old, like, technology and advancement stops.
Mm-hmm.
And that's one of the things we learned in the philosophy class that Aristotle was talking about, or Plato, I forget. But definitely things are intuitive, where you would learn how to and gain knowledge from just trial and error, just a mindset, just what can I do to get this to work?
Yeah. And the third question that we're going to talk about today is, what is the meaning of life?
All right.
So that's a deep question.
I love this question. That is something that people have asked for so long over time. And I've come up with what I think, maybe not the right answer, but it definitely something that people would think about. The meaning of life, for at least your time on Earth here, if that's what you believe in, that you're only here for a certain amount of years, is to make someone else happy, or at least do something for somebody else to make their life better.
Okay.
So what else would you possibly do? What's the meaning of life? Like, why are you here? What's your purpose? Sure, you can, you know, get educated, find an awesome job, make millions of dollars, buy a mansion and a Ferrari, but I don't think that's the meaning of life. The meaning of life is to take the time to interact with other people, make, do things for them, or at least talk to them to make their life better. So when you say the meaning of life, it's your whole purpose on Earth is to interact with others and make it a more positive place for them and yourself to live.
I feel like this kind of begs the question on what is happiness then? Or like, how do you make someone happy?
Okay, well, I don't think one person could make another person happy. They may help that person be happy.
Say
a man and a woman meet, and the woman was lonely, or the man was lonely, and vice versa. And this other person, you know, clicks with them and interacts with them in a way that they're like, wow, you know, this person is telling me things that I never thought of, how good life can be.
Yeah.
That would make me happy. Like, that, something simple like a...
Yeah.
So the meaning of life is to not only just yourself to interact with other people and do good things for them, but for yourself, you know, you want to be happy and do things and activities that make you happy. You know, if you set goals for yourself that are reasonable,
even if you're working towards making someone else happy or like fulfilling their happiness, to what extent are material items needed or not needed?
I think it would be more of an emotional state that you're going to achieve or help that other person achieve, really, more so. Where that person wants to be with you because the vibes and the feeling that they get, the emotional state that they will be in when they're with you, knowing that you love them or care about them and do things for them, and they do things for you that make you happy and it's, you know, reciprocate. So it's not just the material things at all, you know, love, and they say money can't buy happiness.
Yeah.
You know, you could have this Ferrari, this castle. Like I said, if you're by yourself, like, okay,
yeah.
Well, I'm just sitting in my castle with watching movies by myself or something.
Right.
So there has to be more to it, definitely, than just material things.
Right, right.
Like, all I ask for is a tent on the beach. I'll figure out how to fish and, you know, something like that.
Right.
But yeah, for material things would be, that's more of a luxury than it is anything having to do with the meaning of life and happiness, you know.
So then, like, how come when people are dating, then why do you give people gifts to show that you care, but those are material items?
I think because of the ceremonial part of celebrating someone's life after a year, two, three, ten, whatever it might be.
Okay.
It's more of a societal thing, where you're just so used to that's what you do when it's that person. Christmas, if you celebrate that holiday,
right?
A birthday, like July 4th, people might buy fireworks display because it's something that it's not because material things like, okay, I'm going to give you a gold necklace for your birthday.
Mm-hmm.
It shouldn't be about how much you spent on a necklace.
Yeah.
It's the fact that you're showing that you're willing to give something to somebody to make them happy.
Yeah.
And again, which goes back to my meaning of life, like you're going to do things, not just give gifts on birthdays, but establish a life together.
More like societal norms rather than necessarily.
Because if you don't give somebody a gift for their birthday, oh, did you forget me? I don't care.
Yeah.
You know? Wow, I thought
that would make them unhappy, which is not what you want.
No, not what you want. They would say, oh, I thought I meant something to you.
Right.
You know?
Yeah.
An anniversary or something, and even if you're just dating. You forgot. Yeah. We've been dating for a year and you don't even care.
Right.
So,
yeah.
So, in a way, giving a gift for something like, even if it's just flowers,
mm-hmm.
it's the remembrance of that person. Showing appreciation for that person by, material goods. But it doesn't have to be that. You could just cook them dinner, which I guess you could say that's material goods in a way. But
it's more of a necessity.
An action.
Yeah,
an action you're performing.
Mm-hmm.
Wash the person's car if you're husband or wife, either one, maybe the wife decides she's going to mow the lawn, so when the husband comes home, wow, you did that for me? Oh, I can relax, sit back now.
That's true.
So, so instead of material things, it could be an action that that person does.
Okay.
Which makes the other person happy.
Yeah, yeah. So throughout the conversation, we've mostly been talking about, significant others. Is that the primary meaning of life is to make your significant other happy, or can that come in other
I think it would
ways?
Come in other forms as well, even with pets and animals. If an animal, a dog or a cat, whatever, knows that it's in your home and it associates with you, it's, oh, that's the one that feeds me, it gives me a bath, if they like the bath, things like that. They say dog is man's best friend.
Yeah.
Could be woman's best friend too. So there are other other people or creatures that you could associate with that would make your meaning of life, making them happy, more of what life should be.
Mm-hmm.
It doesn't have to be significant other, it could be parents. The meaning of life, say a son or a daughter goes to college and graduates.
Mm-hmm.
They're doing it for themselves, but at the same time, their parents are very proud.
Yeah.
So that part of your meaning of life is that you're making somebody else happy by doing something for yourself. And it's not a materialistic thing like giving gifts for birthdays. It's just progressing in life.
Right.
So you're making yourself happy. And it doesn't have to be college. You can go into the military or whatever.
Right.
Parents are proud that my son is a Marine.
Mm-hmm.
Or daughter, both, but anything that actions that you do that make the world a better place is what the meaning of life. That's why you're here.
That's great to hear.
Okay, thanks.
Thank you.